Gods and demons, this is Nurse Hatchet, She-Wolf of the Wolf Pack.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and ghouls, step right up. Behind this curtain lies a ghastly concoction of delight, horror, fantasy, and terror. Your every wish is our command, your every whimsical desire brought to life. But I'm warning you, there's always a price. Welcome to the greatest show on earth!
The Eric Morse Project, outpostavenna.com, and Fossil Films presents Astro Comics Space Dogs Retro Radio Theater, hosted by Balkazar, Emperor of Evil, Child of Destruction, and Astro Atomic Space Dog!
Disclaimer: any celebrity imitation done on this show is done purely for fun and is not supposed to be taken as a true interpretation of the personality of the person imitated, nor their views. Don't kill us, we're just crazy people, and it's all for fun. Hello, humans. This is your future master, Balkazar, Emperor of Evil, Child of Destruction. Meow. Welcoming you to this edition of Retro Radio Theater. And with me, thank God, is the flea bag, Astro Atomic Space Dog. Oh yes, I'm definitely happy to see you back, Fleabag. Oh, you're wondering what you missed. Oh, it was a very interesting show last month. Our wonderful host got me a psycho woman as an assistant, and she treated me to an examination. Let me just say I needed a smoke afterwards. Unfortunately, Morse was kind enough to hire the crazy woman for the rest of the month, so I've been on the run since. I must look like skin and bones. I'm not fat. There's just more of me to admire and worship. Meow. Anyway, during my busy month, I decided that rather than find another assistant for this insignificant show, I would instead find minions to do my bidding and help me when it comes time to release my evil schemes on the world. So with that in mind, I would like to introduce the first of my minions, a former actor turned evil, Bill Paxton. It's doomsday, man! End of the world! Hollywood refuses to give me the good parts, so now they must pay! I mean, man, that bastard John Hughes! What an insult! He had that chick turn me into a fly-eating fart monster! And what about Cameron? He makes me the whining marine in Aliens, then has Arnold Schwarzenegger hold me over a cliff and make me pee my pants! Assholes! The critics said I was outclassed by a big wind when I did Twister! What about Frailty, man? Fuck! Best role I had... and it was ignored by the Oscars. Fuck them. Fuck Nolan, too. I could have been the Joker. Hell, he could have had the Joker in the next film because I wouldn't die like Ledger. And what kills my career? Fucking Cameron again. Why did I give him another chance? Titanic. My career dies, but DiCaprio's comes out better than ever. I'll destroy that fucking limp dick first. I fucking hate him. Okay, that's enough. Now go to the corner and play with your ball like a good minion. Hey, man, don't be talking to me like that, man. I'm not some piece of shit you can order around. Now, I'm going to go over there and play with my ball. Not because you ordered it. Because I don't take orders. But because I want to. Whatever. As you wish. Arr, arr, arr. Shut up, Fleabag. Okay, well, we are going to have a wonderful show for you tonight. We start with the second episode of our 12-part series of Buck Rodgers in the 25th century, which reminds me, Morse, you got that wrong last month. Naughty. Also, we will thrill you with another Racks and Razzles thriller. This month, we have the first part of a two-part story. The Inn of the Fisherman's Widow. It is a truly frightening tale and well worth having on two shows. So let us begin by taking you to the 25th century with Buck Rodgers.
Buck Rodgers in the 25th century!
Buck Rodgers is on the air, brought to you by the makers of Popsicle, Fudgicle, and Creamsicle, those delicious frozen confections on a stick. And now a message from the famous winner of the Typical American Boy Contest, Popsicle Pete.
Hello, everyone. Say, I wish you were here at the studio. What a room full of gifts you'd see. All for you. Roller skates, table tennis, cameras, fishing tackle, jewelry, dolls. Gosh, hundreds of things. You know how to get them? Just eat Popsicle, Creamsicle, and Fudgicle, and save the bags.
Well, could anything be easier? Enjoy a great, big, delicious Popsicle, Fudgicle, or Creamsicle every day, and get wonderful gifts for the bags. A mother knows these frozen confections on a handy stick are pure and good for you, made fresh every day. And boy, do they taste good. Refreshing, nourishing, so big and only 5 cents.
Don't forget, save bags every day for swell gifts. Get that wonderful free Popsicle gift list in your ice cream store. Tells you how many bags you need for the gift you want. And it's got a free coupon worth 10 bags.
And now for another thrilling episode of Buck Rodgers. Back in 1919, you know, Buck was in the lower workings of an abandoned mine near the city of Pittsburgh when suddenly the walls caved in and a peculiar gas caused him to be held in a state of suspended animation for 500 years. Finding himself in the strange and exciting world of the 25th century, Buck quickly adapted himself to the use of rocket-powered spacecraft and other marvelous scientific developments that would seem almost impossible in our present day. With Wilma Deering and Dr. Huer, Buck has visited Mars, Venus, and Jupiter, Saturn, and even far-off Pluto. His life has been just one amazing adventure after another. Now, in our last episode, you remember, Buck, Wilma, and Dr. Huer were discussing a new instrument for use on a rocket plane when suddenly... But let's join them there in Dr. Huer's laboratory. Okay? Then here we go 500 years into the future.
Yes, Wilma? If this new instrument does what I feel sure it will, there'll be practically no limit to the speed a rocket ship can attain immediately upon taking off.
Good night. Imagine getting into the control cabin, opening the power lever, and going a couple of thousand miles an hour just like that.
Well, when can we test it out, Dr. Hewer? Have you already got it installed on a rocket ship?
No, Buck. As a matter of fact, I don't even have it yet.
Huh?
One's been made up all right, the one we use for the test, but it isn't right here yet.
I don't understand, Doctor.
Well, yes, sir. Can't we get it here? The sooner we can start trying it out, the sooner we can break the monotony of just sitting around here doing
nothing. Wait, Buck. Listen.
Yes, Doctor, I hear it, too.
Well, yeah.
Hear it?
Yes, sir, but what under the sun is it?
Look here, out of the window.
Look, good heavens, Wilma. It's coming right down this way. Wilma! Ah!
Good night.
Hey, come on, folks. Whoever's in that rocket ship that crashed out there is going to need help.
Yes, Buck.
Come on.
Hey, would you, Buck? It looked to me as though it deliberately cracked up right outside this laboratory.
Wilma's right, Buck. Certainly didn't look like a ship out of control.
Well, you can hardly call it an ordinary landing, and we'd better give whoever's in it... Hey, look, it's a Martian ship.
Right. See, the metal door on the side of it is open.
Wait. Wait, it's all right.
Wait?
All right, Doctor. Well, the people in that ship
wait,
must be...
Buck. And listen.
You see, now, it's just exactly like I told you to be. Here we are, safe and sound, and... right on time.
Black Barney.
Well, I'll be doggone.
I sure don't think we needed to land that fast, Mr. Barney.
And Willie's with him.
You see? He made me skin my knee against the control board.
Well, what difference does that make? We had to get down here into a hurry, didn't we?
My knee hurts, too.
And the only way was to land in a hurry so as we... Huh?
See?
Say, you did kind of get scratched up there now, didn't you?
Yes, sir.
Here, Willie, you just put your arm around my shoulder and I'll carry you right straight over to a hospital. Yeah.
Well, it didn't hurt that bad, Mr. Barney.
What do you mean it ain't hurt that bad?
Only I just thought maybe you didn't care.
Oh.
And anyhow, what about that important package you have on board here for Dr. Hewer?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yes, sir, we better get that gyro thing in Dr. Hewer's laboratory right this minute.
We'll take care of it, Barney.
Huh? Oh, hello, Dr. Hewer.
Hello.
Hello, Willie.
How are you? Say, Doctor, how'd you know we'd got here?
Don't worry, Barney. After that landing, the whole city knows you're here.
He didn't say so. It's a wonder you didn't break your neck.
Well, Dr. Hewer was in a hurry to get a hold of that gyro thing we brought down from Mars, so I figured the quicker we landed with it, the better.
Well, I hope it's all right after that landing.
Oh, sure it is, Doctor. I got it stowed away in the shock-insulated storage cabin.
Fine. Then my suggestion is that we fly right over to the spaceport. We'll have the gyrocosmic relativator installed on a ship I have waiting for it over there.
Oh, good. Then we can go right ahead and test it out.
Yes.
Well, Willie here needs to expose his bruised knee to a healing ray for a few minutes.
Well, that's all right, Lieutenant Wilmer.
No, sir, now, Willie. You do what Lieutenant Wilmer says to do.
It doesn't hurt, though. Much.
Well, I'll tell you what. Barney... My little rocket roadster is parked out back of the laboratory building.
Yeah?
So you and Willie hop into that and go over to the hospital where they'll take care of that bruised knee. And meanwhile, we three will take this ship of yours over to the spaceport and install the gyrocosmic relativator on whatever sort of craft Dr. Hewer has waiting for it over there.
Okay, Captain Rogers, we'll do it. Come on, Willie.
Yes, sir. See you later.
All right, Willie.
Wait a minute. Listen, Doctor.
Yes, Barney?
Are you three going to try out that gyro thing, or are you going to have somebody else do it for you?
Why, we'll do it, of course.
Well, are you sure it won't be too dangerous, Doctor?
Dangerous? Oh, no.
Well, don't you laugh, Doctor. If it'll do all the things you told me by radio it would do, why... It sounds to me like it might be dangerous or stuff.
No, not at all. And if you hustle over to the hospital with Willie, you can probably get out of the spaceport before we take off with it.
Yeah, okay, Doctor, you're okay. Hey, come on, Willie.
And come on, Wilma, Doctor. Let's get aboard here and over to the spaceport.
Yes, Buck. Now is the time to test this gyrocosmic relativator here. I'm almost as excited about it as you appear to be.
All set, Buck. There's the metal door.
Right. Want to take the controls, Doctor?
All right, Buck. Here we go.
Never know this ship had been through that crash landing, would you?
Well, I don't know whether you've noticed it, Buck, but all these Martian ships are made very solidly.
Yeah, that's true. They're not very fast, but tough.
Well, isn't that perfectly natural? They're all made under Barney's supervision.
Right. But while you're steering us over to the spaceport, Doctor, I'm going to unpack the gyrocosmic relativator back here. Then we can begin installation on the other ships just as soon as we get there.
That's a good idea, Buck. And I'll radio ahead to Joe Martin there at the spaceport to have men and tools ready in order to save time. Calling Joe Martin at spaceport. This is Dr. Hewer calling Joe Martin at spaceport. Men fade the bank of photoelectric cells into that aperture in the main bank of rocket tubes.
Yes, sir, Dr. Yor. All right, Al, swing it right over here.
That's it. And as soon as you're through with the installation, have all this machinery cleared away.
Yes, sir. Should be all set for the tryout in a couple of minutes now, shouldn't it, Doctor?
Yes, Buck. Just as soon as they finish bolting down that side plate.
Oh, good. I'm anxious to get started with this experimental flight.
Wonder if Barney and Willie will get here before we take off. Barney apparently was quite interested in the gyrocosmic relativator.
Now, how about this power line, Doctor?
Oh, plug it into outlet number one there, Buck.
All right, sir. There it is, Doctor. It's all right. Uh-oh.
What's the matter, Buck?
Oh, nothing. I just scratched the back of my hand a bit, that's all.
All ready for the takeoff now, Doctor.
Fine, Joe. Tell your men to clear away and we'll go right up.
Yes, sir. They're on their way back to the main hangar now.
Good. Well, Buck,
yeah.
Wilma.
Say, look here, Buck. You've taken a really big piece of skin off the back of your hand here.
Oh, forget it. Let's get up in the air in this rocket ship.
Sir, you're as bad as Willie was. Joe?
Yes, Lieutenant?
Don't you have a healing ray in your office?
Oh, sure, Lieutenant. Oh, forget it, Wilma. It'll be all right.
No, sir. Come on over to the office with me, and we'll put your hand under the healing ray for a minute.
Well, but... Oh, okay.
I'll go along with you so I can report to Central Radio Bureau and tell them where we are.
It's this way, right over here.
Silly to worry about a little scratch like this, Wilman. I'm anxious to get aloft for that gyrocosmic relativator on the ship.
Right in here, Lieutenant Wilma. The healing ray's right there in the corner.
Here, Buck. Now put your hand under it while I turn it on.
Okay.
There now. And don't turn it off until your hand is completely healed.
No, let's see. Where's this radio unit of yours, Joe?
Right here, Doctor. Oh, excuse me, sir. There's a call coming in on it now. Central Spaceport. Joe Martin speaking.
Central Radio Bureau. Have you seen anything of Dr. Hewer? I've been trying to locate him all over the city.
Why, sure. He's right here. Here, Doctor. This call's for you.
Oh, thank you. Is it Dr. Hewer?
Urgent message for you, Dr. Hewer. The captain of the rocket police.
Yes?
Says that one of the air guards has just discovered that your laboratory has been forcibly entered and completely ransacked.
What? Why, I just left there a few minutes ago.
Well, it was only discovered a couple of minutes ago. Shall I tell the captain you'll be right over?
No. No, as long as the rocket police are already there, no more damage will be done. I'm engaged in a very important experiment here that I can't leave at the moment. But I'll go back to my laboratory just as soon as I've finished with it. Meantime, they'll know what measures need to be taken and can proceed accordingly.
Yes, sir.
Signing off.
Signing off.
Well, I can't say that I like that.
Say, maybe we'd better postpone this test, Doctor.
No, Buck. It's the most important thing we have at hand right now. And we'd better go through with it.
Well, whatever you say.
But I wonder who could have done it. Surely Black Barney
wouldn't have. Powerful old Barney might absentmindedly pull a locked door off its hinges to get in, but certainly he wouldn't be involved in ransacking my laboratory.
And anyhow, he's probably out at the test ship wondering why we don't get started.
Yes. Well then, come along.
Better wait a second, Doctor. It may be another call for you. Central Fix. Oh, yes, sir. It's for you, Captain Rogers.
Okay, Joe, thanks. Buck Rogers speaking.
Central Radio, Captain. Order from the Office of the President. The entire rocket police fleet has been placed at your disposal.
What?
All regular patrol ships are standing by awaiting your orders. You have full authority to proceed along any lines you may see fit.
Now, wait a minute. Is this because of the trouble at Dr. Hewer's laboratory?
No, sir. Something happened to one of the guards at the municipal prison. The automatic alarm system was completely wrecked. that the guard found lying in a storage room under the effects of a paralysis ray.
Great Scott, man, who did it?
Killer Kane and Ardala. They've escaped.
Doctor, Romy, did you hear that?
Yes, sir.
The worst criminals the solar system has ever known.
How could Kane and Ardala have escaped?
I don't know, but one thing's sure. We're going to have to call off this test flight.
Not at all, Buck.
Huh?
Now we must go ahead with it.
But, Doctor...
It'll take far more than the ordinary rocket ship to track down that pair. And that's just exactly what our gyrocosmic relativator will provide.
Dr. Hugh is right, Buck.
Okay, then. Come on, let's go.
There's the ship. Just waiting for us. And we can take off in it immediately.
Well, come on.
No, look!
There it goes! There goes our ship!
Well, somebody beat them to it. If you ask me, there's trouble ahead for our friends. Fellas and girls, is each day bringing you closer to those wonderful presents Popsicle Pete picked out for you? Are you saving bags for books and cameras, musical instruments, fishing tackle, dolls, jewelry, all the exciting things you want? Well, save bags every day from Popsicle, Fudgicle, and Creamsicle, and you'll soon have just the gifts you want.
Say, kids. Did you ever try a creamsicle? Gee, it's wonderful. A great big chunk of delicious ice cream on a stick, coated with thick, chewy butterscotch.
Or you can get creamsicle coated with chocolate fudge or fresh fruit flavors. They're wholesome, too, full of the kind of nourishment we all need. And only a nickel for a great big creamsicle on a handy stick.
And don't forget to save the bags for those swell gifts.
That was marvelous. Now let us join our host, Eric Morse, for another horror news update. Oh, oh! Gore and scares, everyone. This is William Pattison, a.k.a. Eric Morse, with your horror news update for May 2010. This month, it appears we have a theme going on. Let's get started. The much-anticipated independent feature film, The Tenant, has reached completion and expectations are high. The Tenant brings together a dramatic, classic feel with its tale of horror at Edgewood Asylum and transforms into a modern-day masterpiece of mayhem with outstanding special effects and surprising twists. As the tormented Dr. Newman conducts his dark experiments inside Edgewood Asylum, something goes horribly wrong. 28 years later, in the depths of the asylum, something evil survives. The Tenant takes you on a terrifying ride of shocking images and a bloody conclusion. Under the direction of maverick filmmaker Rick Lamonte, The Tenant promises anguishing intrigue and an astounding twist and a chilling conclusion. Let's check out the trailer.
I want you to stop wasting your time and our money on these useless experiments.
I'm a landlord, taking care of a bunch of tenants.
I just felt the baby cat in the furniture.
Ryan. Edgewood Asylum.
I know this place.
This place ought to keep us warm until tomorrow. And we'll get that door open. And we'll get the hell out of here.
Jay LaRose headlines this classic monster movie. Other stars include Randy Muller and includes internationally known horror icon Michael Berryman and Bill Cobbs. I will keep you updated on when this film is released. The Resident is a thriller being released under the reconstituted Hammer Films banner and features Oscar-winning actress Hilary Swank, Jeffrey Dean Morgan from Supernatural and The Watchmen, and Hammer alumni Christopher Lee. After separating from her husband, a pretty young doctor moves to Brooklyn and settles into a new life in a stunning, spacious loft apartment that seems too good to be true. It is. Mysterious occurrences lead her to suspect that she is not alone in her home, and quickly her fears become all too real. In a chilling revelation, she discovers that her seemingly charming young landlord, Max, has developed a dangerous obsession with her. A terrifying game of cat and mouse ensues as she fights to free herself from Max's sinister intentions. Let's check out the trailer. Erotic and sexy thriller in the vein of Disturbia and Fatal Attraction is written by Antti Jokinen and Robert Orr, and Erin Casita Wilson. Antti Jokinen directs. Once again, I'll keep you updated on this film in a future installment. Well, that is our horror news update for this month. Be ready for more gore and scares next month. Until then, keep America strong. Keep watching horror films. We'll be right back. Another fascinating report. Excuse me, Bill Paxton. Didn't I order you a while back to go to the Daily Boost and get me my caramel macchiato? Hey, man, I don't take orders from no one, especially not a fat-ass cat. Excuse me, what was that, you piddly minion? Oh! I want to hear it from his lips, Fleabag, if he dares. I said I don't take orders from a fat... Ow!
Meow!
Hello, listeners. This is William Pattison, a.k.a. Eric Morse. Unfortunately, Balkazar is busy yet again with another assistant, so it's up to me to keep the show going. So, on to our next thrilling radio play. Our friends at Racks and Razors bring us the terrifying story of the Inn of the Fisherman's Widow. This is a two-part story, and we will have the second half on our next Retro Radio Theater. So, let's go have a pint and a scare at the Inn of the Fisherman's Widow. Enjoy! Oh!
It was getting late into November. The leaves had long since bid their farewell to the trees and were beginning their inevitable decay back into the earth. Rain and wind drove itself across the graying countryside of Curaclo in an attempt to be drawn out to sea. Winter had always looked so fitting in this dismal landscape, almost as though it were in a constant mourning for some unheard-of thing. A red car broke up the landscape, slicing through the faded grays and greens, uttering random chunks and belches as the driver struggled through the gears.
My God, this place is so dreary. I'm so excited. It's exactly like my grandmother said, steeped in history.
Yeah, well, Jane, once you can show us some hot Irish lads and a cute little pub, I'll start to be impressed. So far, the history of some depressing, middle-of-nowhere little village ain't too appealing.
A hot Irish girl wouldn't go amiss either, you know. This is supposed to be a holiday to heal my broken heart, in case you've forgotten.
Will the two of you stop being so pessimistic, please? I'm telling you, you'll be kissing my ass once we're through with this holiday. Romances or no romances.
Okay. Ugh, God, I hate these roads. Andy, when do I turn right? What was the name of the hotel we're staying at again?
The Inn at the Fisherman's Widow. Probably some tourist trap.
Shut up, Andy. Tara, take the next right.
Now, in the small village of Curaclo, a legend lies. One so dark and evil that for it to be spoken of is a terrible thing. The Inn of the Fisherman's Widow, as our travelers are yet to find out, has kept the legend safe for many years. Passed down through generations, the story, however unbelievable or terrifying, has been respected and treasured. For it is with great pride that the villagers hold this story safe. The story which was about to open a new chapter. The Inn of the Fisherman's Widow is surprisingly busy. Pints are being poured, customers are talking in low, hushed tones. Our three travelers enter through the front door, sending a gust of wind in with them.
Whoa, would you look at this place? This is authentic. I mean, this is like, pour me a stout and let's get merry authentic.
I know, and I think I see a very cute barman. I'm gonna go get us some drinks. You two find us some seats.
God, the first guy in sight. Oh, hey, look, there's some seats behind that old man.
Are you for real? Doesn't he give you the creeps?
Come on, you big chicken. Have you never spoken to an old person before?
Not if I could avoid it, actually. No.
Well, you can't avoid it. We're going to speak to him. I need to find out about the area. I didn't see a tourist office anywhere around, did you?
Okay, well, not too long. It's getting late.
Hello there. Mind if we share the table?
I was saving these seats for some friends who were coming along to buy me a pint, but do as you please.
Would you like a drink, Mr.?
I'll have a pint of the black stuff, if you're offering so.
Sure. Andy, would you be so kind as to get him a drink, please? I gather you live around here?
Yes.
Well, my grandmother lived here when she was a child. She can't really remember much, and I was wondering if I could maybe gather some stories for her.
Well, people say there's nothing to know about Curaclo. That's the truth of it.
Well, I'm sure there is. I mean, like, why is the town called Curaclo?
Well, the name comes from a boat. An old Irish boat. They say that a Curaclo is a boat of the dead. It is a boat that ferries the souls across the sea to the land of the spirits. I'm thinking this town must have reminded them of death. Oh.
I see. So if you don't mind me asking, why is it called the Inn of the Fisherman's Widow?
Oh, so you've never heard the tale of the Fisherman's Widow girl?
Is that like a ghost or something?
Close. You see, the Fisherman's Widow is said to have once lived in this village. She was made a widow when she lost her husband at sea. It's a sad tale. The story goes that they were very much in love, and that they spent every day together out on their cura fishing. On successful days they were, too, for some believe the cura was a blessed boat. Then, one afternoon, while they were out fishing, they were attacked by a group of young lads who captured their cura and threw the fisherman and his wife overboard. No one knows for certain who they were or why they attacked the fisherman and his wife, but some said they wanted the boat for themselves. In the end, the fisherman was never found. But his wife was saved, dragged to shore, barely alive. She was saved, but she was never again the same. After losing both her husband and her boat, she lost her mind as well. She took to walking among the rocks along the shore, standing in the wind and rain, screeching his name out to sea. At every funeral after, she could be seen following the death march, pulling her hair and wailing terrible. Some say she was looking to see if her husband lay beneath the shroud. Well, in time, people came to fear, keeping their children away from the funerals, worried that the widow would appear. They thought that she'd developed an evil streak since she'd lost the fisherman. The villagers were certain that it was the curse of death that she carried with her. Then, after a time, she disappeared. 'Twas said that she was just walking into the sea, wailing and wanting to join her husband. Whatever happened, she just vanished. And Curaclo was blessed with peace again. So there you have it. A tale worth telling. And worth another pint, to be sure.
Sad stuff.
It's not that scary. I mean, she's dead, and by the sounds of it, so's that story.
No, you see, there's more told me by me da. Before he died, he told me of the widow's return. Thank you. You see, just after the fisherman's widow disappeared, a young lad died in what seemed a fishing accident. He was killed in the most horrendous of ways, his body tangled in the net, sliced up and dashed against the rocks. There were only wee bits when they found him. There were something so nasty about his death that some began to think again about the fisherman's widow. Could it have been her spirit, seeking revenge against young sailors of the sort that had killed her husband? Then, at the wake, with the whole village there, they heard it. A wailing more terrible and horrifying than ever before conceived. The shrieking continued on and on through the night, tormenting every living soul that heard it. Now that was the first death, and first death at sea after the fisherman himself. But there were more deaths to come, each more terrible than the one before, and not all just young men. Children are killed and mothers too. So far, 9 funerals have witnessed the widow's wailing.
So, has anyone ever seen her?
Yes. Me father saw her just before he died. He said that he could hear her inside his head almost, and then she appeared, rapping at his window with her bony fist, skin bloated and gray, hanging from her wiry frame. Naked she was, except for a shroud gathered round her hips, her head half bald and doused with seawater. Just holes in her head where her eyes should have been. The skin on her chest eaten away, he said, bones revealed as hollow as driftwood. To look at her, me father said, was to look at death itself. So there you have it, children. The tale of the fisherman's widow.
Wow. What a story. Truly freaky.
Yeah, terrifying. Thanks for sharing it. But you know, we have really got to get going. It's late and I don't fancy the drive in this weather.
Right. When you go out the door of the pub, you turn left. And when you get to the end of the village, on the left-hand side, you'll see Bridie's room and house, facing the water. I'd show you myself, but I'm still waiting for me friend to come along and buy me that pint.
Wow, that actually sounds great right now. I'm so tired. I'll just go and let Tara know that we're staying there for the night. Oh, Andy, look. Seems to be getting on great with that barman.
We'd better warn her about the fisherman's widow.
Oh, my God. I swear, I never kiss the first time I meet someone. It's just that your accent is irresistible. And possibly the fact that you gave me 2 free pints. Say my name again.
Tara. All right, Tara. Here, let's get you home.
Okay. Don't you get a little scared walking these old roads at night? It's so dark. Haven't you guys ever heard of electricity?
Very funny. No, I don't mind it one bit. It's peaceful. A lot of villagers are scared, though. They say the widow will get you if you stroll the roads too late. What a load of horse trollop.
The widow? What's that?
Just some stupid story to stop people making too much noise after dark. Now come here and give me another one of your lovely kisses.
Cheeky. Is that you? Jeez, Mark!
No, it's not me. I thought I was just getting you excited.
Oh my God, why is that pervy old woman staring at us?
What? Run now, Tara!
Jane, are you okay?
Yeah. Oh God, what a horrible nightmare. I dreamt that I saw her. The fisherman's widow. Oh God. I feel kind of sad too. Where's Tara? Isn't she back yet?
Doesn't look like it. She must have really got on with that barman. God, it's late as well. 3:30.
Wait. Shh. Can you hear that?
It's coming from outside the window.
Oh, God. the hell is it?
Andy, will you have a look?
There, revealed behind the curtains, was something so revolting and terrifying that it can only be described in words. To set eyes upon it would possibly paralyze you with fear. There, hanging just outside the window, was the figure of a woman, eyes rolled back and her hair pulled from her head.
Oh my God!
The fisherman's widow!
No, Andy, that's Tara!
Then how is she screaming? Her mouth is sewn shut.
Yes, indeed. Where is that screaming coming from?
The Inn of the Fisherman's Widow. Directed by Heath Arada. Written by Laura O'Connor. Narrated by Bruce Pollock. Starring Greg Titterington as Andy, Cheryl Thompson as Jane, Kiwi Phillips as Tara, Richard Floyd as the Old Man, Chad Riley as the Barman. Sound design by SweetSweetProduction.com. Dave Cockrum and Heath Arada. RacksandRazors.com or MySpace.com/RacksandRazorsRadioShow.
Hello, humans. I'm back after having to discipline my unruly minion. Unfortunately, I've had to give Bill Paxton his walking papers. I cannot tolerate disloyalty in my minions. But be assured, I will have another one next month, and I'm sure this one will be a world of difference. Now, all this activity has made me crave a caramel macchiato even more. Would you be so kind to have someone go to the Daily Boost and get me one more? That's a good man. My pleasure, Balkazar. I'll just have my new assistant do that for you. Maria! Oh, no.
Oh, there you are, Mr. Tinkles, you naughty kitty. It's time for me to check your ears.
No. No one hand me, crazy woman. Get away from me with that Q-tip. Oh, damn you, Morse, I'll get you for this. I promise you. No more, no more.
Well,
Balkazar refreshes himself, let's acknowledge our sponsors. The Eric Morse Project is sponsored by FrightStuff.com, DK New York Effects, Dr. Blood's Video Vault, HorrorDemons.com, BenevolentStreet.com, Brass Services, and Fossil Films. The official coffee place of our show is the Daily Boost, Courthouse Square, Redwood City, California. The official sandwich place is Ike's Place, 16th Street and Sanchez, San Francisco, California, and also at 555 Twin Dolphin Drive, number 115, Redwood City, California. All of our shows are dedicated to the internet's mistress of horror, Dark
spider. This is Balkazar, Emperor of Evil, Child of Destruction, for the Eric Morse Project. Be ready next week for Horror Chat. Stay away from me, crazy woman.
Come here, Mr. Tinkles. I need to check your sphincter again, naughty kitty.
Help me. Back next month with more thrills and chills with Balkazar and Atomic Space Dog.
Help me.
So, always remember, keep America strong. Listen to Retro Radio.
You know you love the summer.
Phoenix Comics and Toys. Hello, creeps. Get your one-of-a-kind custom horror host figurines. That's right, kiddies. Oh, you can find hosts like the Keymaster, Mummy and the Monkey. I just love that name. Mr. Lobo, or even Carlos Borloff's Monster Madhouse. Tell him your bony little friend, the Crypt Keeper, sent you. It won't get you a discount, but it might get you killed. Phoenix Comics and Toys.
It's Spooky Boo from Spooky Boo Scary Story Time. Grab a glass of wine, a nice warm blanket, and a pair of headphones and listen to the spooky tales of the internet. Some of the stories I write, some are creepypasta, others are sent in by listeners. You'll enjoy falling asleep to these spooky, scary stories. Now get ready, and I'll see you in your nightmare.
Ah!